our hearts mean. We know a circumcising of the flesh, what that is. But why would God use circumcision as a way for us to understand the concept of circumcising our hearts? Removing impurities, yep.
Also fulfilling part of what is there.
Okay. How about also that the circumcision of the flesh is a picture of the circumcision of our spirits, of our hearts. It's getting away, getting rid of that thick protrusion that causes us to not see God or hear God or listen to Him, right? It's getting rid of that which gets in our way. Anyway, so God calls them a stiff-necked people, which means that they're thick-headed. You know, they're not listening. They're still doing their own thing, right? What's that?
Stubborn and
unwilling to do what God has called them to do. Now, is he saying that about everybody? Not necessarily, but we might as well just put ourselves in there because we do it too, right? We think that we know better than God. Many times we do. Or sometimes we're uncomfortable doing what he asks, so we don't do it, right? So what does it mean to have a circumcised heart? It means that you do love God with your whole body, with your soul, with your mind, with your resources. You do fall. You feel bad about it. You feel remorseful. Or you feel separated from Him. And that's the way we feel separated from God. God is all around us, but when we slip and fall, when we sin, you should have such a relationship with God through prayer, through study, through not just study, but, you know, memorizing God's word, right? Memorizing the teachings of our master. But that when we do make a mistake, because we all do, none of us are perfect. None of us will be perfect until the world to come after the Messianic age. And even so, today, you know, we're not perfect. So we do make mistakes, but we regret it. We feel ashamed. We feel bad that, like we've let God down, you know? If you understand that, is that when you do something and your dad comes to you and says, you know, you let me down. I'm ashamed of you. You know, how much does that tug at your heart when you want approval of your dad and stuff, but you do something and it causes him to be disappointed in you? Yeah, I'd cry, right? Well, that's how we should be with God too, right? We need to take this stuff seriously. Our relationship with God is a serious thing. It's so serious, it's life or death. It's life or death. You know, it's not that we can just, oh, God will forgive me, you know. That's a bad attitude to have, you know. Well, God is always willing to forgive me. We can't have that. We got to do the best we can walking in God's instructions, in His Torah. We're going to make mistakes. So, and it goes on to the writer of Proverbs, which was King Solomon, Shlomo, who wrote that a righteous man, what is a righteous man? It's the one who does the best, that does his best at keeping God's Torah, who has a relationship with God through keeping the Torah and through prayer and so forth, right? It says that a righteous man sins seven times a day. So, as I've said before, you should know what makes him a righteous man. He's no different than anybody else. If he sins, right? It's because he recognizes that sin. He feels that in his heart. He feels that he let God down, right? He feels that separation from God. And he wants that relationship again, right? He wants that relationship to be restored. And so he gets back up. He confesses his sins to God, humbles himself, right? And asks God forgiveness. But he gets back up and keeps moving on. And this is what Moses was teaching us here. All those times that Israel sinned against God, rebelled against God, Moses stood the gap for them, right? He stood the gap for them. He was Messiah at that time, just as Yeshua is our Messiah and the true Messiah, right? And he got the people to renounce their sins, to feel ashamed and feel ashamed and feel remorseful, right? But then what he did, he got them back up and they kept moving forward, right? And they did. They didn't have to. All till it came down to camping across from the land that God was going to give them. And it was the children of the men who God cursed because of their unfaithfulness, because of the spies. They were gone. It was their children now that would inherit the land. And they seed all these things. Were they perfect? No, they had some issues too, right? But they learned from that, right? They learned. They realized God is real. And God even says, you know, your clothes didn't wear out and your feet didn't swell up, right? Your clothes, your shoes, your feet. 40 years of wandering. Well, that is a miracle unto itself. So they seen God in their life every day, right? And we can too. We can see God in our life every day. If we look carefully, he can be found every day. When you get up in the morning, we say the blessing, thanking God for restoring us back to life, right? Thank him for the air we breathe, the things we see, the things we hear, the love we have for each other, for loved ones, and for the food that he provides for us every day. Thank God for that. Bless God, right? That's what it says in here too. When we've eaten our fill and are satisfied, then thank God for the food in the land, right? And for those who don't know, in the church, you know, they as we have read, they pray before they eat, but they pray a blessing. They bless the food, right? And it's okay, but we also bless God, just as Yeshua did. He broke the bread and thanked God for it, right? And then he distributed it, right? And he did the same thing with the wine. Bless God and then distributed it. Thank God. We don't bless the food. We bless God. That's who we thank. And that it even goes on to say here that there's a time coming when you're going to have your fill, eat everything you want, be satisfied, and you're going to forget me. People need to understand that the reason Israel was taken away, or I should say Judah, the northern tribes were taken away because of their adultery, that they were that they were doing. They forgot God completely and went completely wholeheartedly after the idol worship of the former Canaanites and stuff. Okay? But Judah didn't. But what they did is they forgot God. They left God out. They thought to themselves that, as it says in here, it is my own hand, my own strength that has brought me this wealth. They didn't thank God. They didn't give credit to God. They didn't trust God. They trust only in themselves. And we can't do that. That's why during the Babylonian exile, the men of the great assembly came up with blessings for everyone so we don't forget about God. Okay? There's blessings for everything. And I know people laugh and think it's funny. You know, even in the Fiddler on the Roof, where the one man asked the rabbi, is there a blessing for a sewing machine? And what was his answer? There is a blessing for everything, right? A blessing for everything. Because we don't want to forget God. We've been to Babylon. We don't want to go back. That's a separation from God, right? Even though God did go with us, and we've seen his miraculous hand, especially in the time of Queen Esther and Mordecai, right?
That's it.
Hillside, yeah.
Yeah,
they rebuilt the altars of the false gods and stuff and began that again. Yeah, that's where they walked. They started walking in that direction again. Yeah.
My word, we don't want
to do. So he's talking about is Jeremiah 19, right?
Jeremiah 19.
So something to read, see what's going on there as well, and what God had Jeremiah do. But for ourselves now, you know, we can't ride the coattails of somebody else. You know, now we have national salvation for Israel that's coming, but it's still up to the individual to make that choice. We have to decide what we are going to do. At this point in life, everybody who is born is on the highway to hell, you might say. The separation from God, to not being part of the world to come, right? But God has made a way. You know, he separated out Abraham. Why? Because Abraham was special. Abraham had such a relationship with God that it was different from all the other people. He was the 10th generation from the flood. Noah was the 10th generation from creation, from when Adam and Eve were created, right? There's two different things that took place there. With Noah, the people refused to repent or turn back to God. And so God brought a big flood, but he saved Noah's family, right? But now the same thing comes up with the world again. God calls Abraham. But God isn't going to destroy the world with a flood, right? But he finds a man who is willing to follow his ways, trust him beyond anything. Faith that only we dream about, but we can have also. A relationship with God that is like your best friend standing right here, right? Your husband, your wife, your best friend, it doesn't matter, you know, have a relationship just like that, because God is our best friend. He is our Father, right? And he sent us Yeshua because of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and their descendants. God was able to bring through them the Messiah that would set us apart from the rest of the world, that would, if we would acknowledge him as the Messiah, as the sent one, then we could begin our walk in salvation, begin our relationship with God through him, right? That's what we have there. So if you want to know who Yeshua is, read the Torah. If you want to know what Yeshua came to save us from, look in the mirror. Because he came to save us from ourselves, our own selves is what destroys us. Instead of walking in God's ways, we are given the choice to accept it or reject it. And of course, in this life, we know that part of our DNA is rebellion against God, right? It's easy to do evil here, but it's hard to do good. And when you do good, people criticize you, right? They criticize you. Well, that's backwards from what God originally intended. But because Adam and Eve disobeyed God, it says that when they after Eve had eaten and Adam then ate, that the whole world changed. Their eyes were opened. The earth shook. And in the twinkling of an eye, their DNA changed from that of not having evil and death and stuff in it to one that was now death and destruction. Evil all the time, God says. Tainted, yeah, it was tainted. But Yeshua came as part of God's plan to change us, to make a people ready for the world to come. We're going to go through the Messianic era. The adversary is going to be put in prison, so he can't tempt people, right? He's going to be put away. But at the end of the 1,000 years, he's released again. And yet all these people have lived through this 1,000 years, seeing all the miracles and the plentiness and all these different things, and yet he's going to be able to build an army of human beings who have gone through that, and they reject God. And those people will then be separated, and they will become fire. Fire shall issue from within them. They will be the lake of fire that the Bible talks about. Talking about a grand amount of people. That's what lake, water, clouds, those represent a large amount of people, crowds of people. And that lake of fire is going to be those who will be gathered, and their judgment will be that fire will come, not just a fire like you see here, a holy fire, a consuming fire that not only will consume their flesh, but will consume their soul and their spirit. And it says that they shall cease to exist. It's in Isaiah. They shall cease to exist. That's a fire we have no concept of. God uses fire. He used fire to talk to Moses, but it didn't consume the bush that it was in. Right? It didn't consume it. It was there. So this is a fire that we don't understand. We have no concept of understanding. But who wants to be on that end of that fire? An all-consuming fire. Yeshua said, don't fear those who can kill your body, but fear him who can destroy both your body and your soul. Destroy. Oh, your soul can't be destroyed. I've heard people say that. Oh, yeah? Read Isaiah. It talks about this happening. Yeshua says it. He refers to that. And I'm not trying to scare you into it. I'm just saying those are the things to come if we choose poorly. God's given us a choice. He's given us choices, but it's up to us. We're born going to that lake of fire. But God gives us plenty of opportunities to change the direction, the fate that our lives were born to go to. But it's up to us to make that choice. Cling to God. How? Cling to Yeshua, cling to His Torah, cling to our teacher Yeshua, His teachings. Acknowledge that He is the Messiah, that He is the living Torah. Follow in His ways, His Torah, the best you can, and realize that when you do make a mistake, we all do, God is willing to forgive us. You know, even Yeshua has told me, you asked Him, how many times are we to forgive our brother? Seven times? And He says, seven times 70, times thousands of thousands, right? Forgive him all the time. Why? Because God will do that with us too. But it's through our heart. God knows our heart. If we're if we are really adamant about our relationship with God, that when we sin, we feel ashamed, we feel bad and separated from God, but we stand up and we confess our sins to God. We confess them and repent, turn away from those things, do the best we can, and walk back to Him. He's like the loving Father whose child has wandered away and realized he's made a big mistake, and he comes running back to his dad. His dad's not going to reject him. He's come running back to his dad, right? And he's going to pick him up and hug him and tell him how much he loves him, and that it's okay. Just stay with me. You'll be fine, right? That's what God says to us. That's why He sent Yeshua, to give us that realization, that hope. So as we go this week, think about it. Where are we? How much do we pray to God? How much do we not just pray? And it doesn't have to be a prayer, you know. Talk to God on a regular basis, like you talk to your mother, your dad, your brother, your friend, you know. He's there all the time. And I'm not perfect either. I make mistakes. But I know, and I've seen so much of God's blessings and His deliverances and stuff like that, that I can't deny His existence or the existence that Yeshua is the Messiah. I've tried it before. There's too much evidence out there that shows that He is there, He is with me, that Yeshua is the Messiah. Only a fool, as it says in Proverbs, only a fool denies God. Denies the existence of God. It's because they're blind. They've been blinded by the world, by the flesh, by the materialism. But we need you to look. Seek Him while He may be found. The time's coming when He won't be found. Right? It's like it says about the time of Rosh Hashanah and stuff, that look, behold, the king is in the field. Go and present yourself to the king. It's coming up. Elul is coming up. We've got 30 days before Rosh Hashanah and all these other things that are high holidays coming, you know. So, that's weird. So, let's get out there and do that. Build your relationship with God. It starts with your family first. Ministry always starts with your family. Husband and wife. That's what God originally intended with Adam and Eve. Not Adam and Steve or Don or William, but Adam and Eve, right? To be a team. Be a team player. Right? To work together. So, please, as you're going this week, think about it. Figure out what you need to do to build your relationship with God. Because He's real. He's sad when we're sad. He's happy when we're happy. He's happy for us. But He's also sad for us. And He's sad that people reject Him, you know. That's their choice, though. And he gives it to them. So, if you bow your heads now, we'll do the priestly blessing. Our God and God of our fathers, bless us with the threefold blessing in the Torah, written by the hand of Moses, your servant, and pronounced by Aaron and his servant, his sons, the priests, your holy people, as it is said. May the Lord bless you and protect you. Maybe you will. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. Maybe you will. May the Lord turn his face towards you and grant you peace. Maybe you will. Yivarechach Adonai v'yishmerecha. Ya'er Adonai panav elecha v'chunecha. Yisa Adonai panav elecha v'yisem lecha shalom. Go in peace, and may your Sabbath be wonderful, the rest of your Sabbath, and your week coming up be blessed. Tuesday night is our Torah club. We're on book, or lesson 47, Re'eh, which means to see. Also, keep us up in prayer as we head down to the city soon and get back safely and stuff. In 2 weeks from today is Michael's Bar Mitzvah, September 7th. So we have next weekend will be Re'eh. And the weekend after that will be, the Shabbat after that will be Michael's Bar Mitzvah of Shoftim. So be praying for him. Pray that everything goes well. And just have a great week, everybody. Thank you for coming. So Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat 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 Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat 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 Shalom. Shabbat 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 Shalom. Shabbat 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 Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat 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 Shalom. Good Shabbos.